So let's have a look at my new toy. Or I say new toy, it's actually quite an old toy. I've had it for a couple of years or so, and it's really, really ancient. It came out in 2004. It's that thing there. It's not that. That's the teacup. It's got coffee in it, but it's a multi-purpose cup. It's very important that I stay on topic. Let's do that. I've done that before. That's the guy. This thing, it's a PowerBook G4. It's a titanium PowerBook G4, because this grey stuff is titanium, which is an experiment that Apple tried and then abandoned pretty quickly. Nowadays, they're modern Macintoshes, that one there. They use aluminium. I say modern, this is a 2008 MacBook Pro. I got it second hand, it's still pretty good. The G4 is ancient history now. It was called a TiBook, which I'm not going to use. Technically, it's called a PowerBook G4 Gigabit Ethernet. There were several different models. Let's boot it up. It runs 10.4 Tiger, which is the most modern operating system you can put on it, or the most modern version of OS X. Anyway. Surprisingly, the disk drive still works. The slots at the front here, I'm not sure if it's in the plane of focus. Let's have a sip of coffee whilst it very slowly churns away. Surprisingly dim screen there, but it is 14 years old. Now the G4 models, or the G4, the PowerBook G4 was launched back in 2001. It was very flash at the time. My recollection is that the magazines generally ignored it because back then no one cared all that much about Apple. But it's aged surprisingly well. It's got a 15.4 inch widescreen screen with a resolution of, let's have a look, it changed halfway through, with a resolution of 1152 by 768. You can do you can sort of crush it down to 1024, and then you can go back to, it's like XVGA, I can't remember what that's called. 1152. The back in 2001, widescreen monitors were pretty novel, not just for laptops but for desktops. As far as I can tell, this is the very first laptop with a widescreen display, and it would probably have been better than your desktop computer back then. So it's got built-in AirPort Wi-Fi. AirPort is what Apple people call them, Wi-Fi, but it's not compatible with modern security. So what I've got is a kind of dongle thing attached around the back, which you can't see. Let's open up the screen. Notice I'm doing this sort of gingerly because the hinges were the big weak point in the old TiBooks. They used to break, and the video cable goes through the hinges, and so if one of the hinges breaks, the whole machine is completely useless. That's wireless network utility. I don't actually have any. Let's very slowly load up 10.4 Fox, which is a version of Firefox compiled for the G4 machines. And at this point, have I actually hit record? I have, yes. Let's have a look. Where's 10.4 Fox? Oh, it's not in the modern versions. Like Yosemite is very different from this. I actually quite like Tiger because it's a lot more immediate. You've still got this Go stuff, but you can actually select. It doesn't have this stupid tags that you get down the side. Also, this, like, it's not animated. It doesn't zoom out at you. I hate that. I hate it when things zoom out at you. 10.4 Fox, which sort of half an hour from now when it's loaded up. We shall talk some more. Let's have some more coffee. Now, there were... Sorry, there were basically two different families of the G4 PowerBook. There was the first batch, which that loaded faster than I was expecting. Was it caching something? They all had a maximum of 1 gigabyte of memory, which I've maxed it out, which you can do for about a tenner nowadays. The first couple were, I think, 400 and 500 megahertz. The last ones were just over a gigahertz, or thereabouts. Actually, let's load the BBC News. And halfway through, they increased the screen resolution to 1260 something pixels. and they added a DVI port around the back so that you can connect it up to a large widescreen monitor, such as the thing at the back there. God, my arm is massive. Whoa, a massive arm. Think of the things that arm has done. And yeah, it's very slowly loading there. Oh my God, it actually did work. That's Mo Farah. I think he's a happy man there. Look at him with his little shiny head there. He's actually a very small man, but I suppose as a runner, the smaller you are, the less wind resistance. That's also why he shaves his head. He covers himself in oil. I'm surprised he doesn't wear a kind of cowling around the front of his face. I didn't actually want to click on that. That's it. You could combine that picture and the next picture, and you could have a kind of a 3D image of Mo Farah's head, if you wanted. If that's what you wanted, if that's your goal in life, you could combine that and the pre. Oh, it's like a bullet time thing with it. Shut up. Sorry. Go away, dashboard thing. Right. Oh, yeah, one thing you'll notice, it's got this old fashioned trackpad. Modern Macintoshes just have a large rectangular area. This one has a slightly old fashioned thing. You can tap to click. You've got a single button here, which, and it doesn't do multi-touch, so I can't remember which version you're, which direction you're supposed to scroll on modern Macintoshes. Let's go down. Let's see how Inga destroys it. Is it Inga or Imgur? GIF. It's pronounced GIF. Right, okay, this should absolutely obliterate it because it's going to load a whole amount of animated GIFs. It's not going to do a goddamn thing unless I turn off NoScript. Right, I'm a Nazi like that. You know, I should really have described the G4 first before doing all this, but it would have been tedious. Because this way, I mean, if you think about it, you're watching a video of a man surfing the internet. I mean, you could actually be surfing the internet yourself. So let's see if there's any pictures of Taylor Swift. No pictures of Taylor Swift. I'm actually surprised that this is as fast as it is. I say fast, it's not really fast at all. It's quite slow compared to like a modern tablet, even an Android tablet. It's vastly inferior, but is that a fox? No. Usually something exciting leaps out at me here, but in this case, absolutely nothing. It's just a tedious load of crap. But that's Imgur for you. That's enough of this gay banter. Let's leave it running in the background. Let's see if we can tax this powerhouse of machine. Let's pop open Mac Tracker, which has got a list of all the different PowerBook models. Back on topic. Which one? Mine's the Gigabit Ethernet model there. Let's pop it open. Again, you're watching someone surf the internet. Back in the day, PC laptops were generally pretty grotty in terms of graphics. The Macintoshes had separate graphics cards. Now this will run an external monitor. What does it say? Does it say something about an external monitor? At least up to 14.4. No, I think I managed to run it at 1920 by 1080. I'm not sure if the original version of OS X 1 or whatever, 10.1 that came with it, would have been able to do that, but certainly the... I'm distracting myself because I'm actually reading this whilst trying to talk at the same time, which involves doing two things, also breathing as well, and trying not to drool, which is... it has a VGA connector. The later versions had a DVI connector, and if you want to buy one of these nowadays, there's really no reason not to buy the... very last of the line, which is the 1 gigahertz model with a DVI connector. This one has a resolution of 1152 by 768 pixels. The later versions had a resolution of 1280 by 854, which was not bad in, when did it come out? 2002. Bearing in mind that until quite recently you could get PC Ultrabooks with 1376 by 768 displays, and this is like 13 years later. Now, it had a faster bus, better superdrive. The superdrive of mine still works. I think I've mentioned that before. How much did it cost? It was $3,000 there for the last of the line. My, from what I remember, the very first titanium G4 was hugely expensive. It came out for £3,500 there for the top model. But they very quickly discounted that, $3,500. Because at the time, all laptops were expensive, but they were rapidly coming down in price because they were powerfully desirable. So the, yeah, this particular model came out in late 2001, early 2002, and cost, it was still pretty expensive, still £3,000. Now let's pop open a couple of the applications that I have. I do use this very occasionally. The battery, it's got a new battery, so it lasts for about 5 hours. The, I'm burping. I'll edit that out later on. It's because I just had some coffee. Does coffee make you, I don't know, it's, no. I'll edit that out. You won't hear that bit. You'll be confused as to what I'm talking about now. Right, let's pop open Bean. This is Bean, a very simple text editor with a spell checker that it may or may not be named after top former NASA astronaut Alan Bean, who was the fourth person to stand on the moon or something like that. Was he? Let's pop open Safari, which is a native Macintosh browser, the most recent version of Safari. You can see Safari open really quickly there. Where's the About Safari? There it is. Version 4.1.3. Now, in a rational Windows world, the About screen is down here, but for some reason, Macintosh people, they do it differently. Let's look up Alan Bean. Alan Bean. It's actually pronounced Bourne. Alan Bourne. Alan Bourne. And he dies. He hasn't died yet, obviously. He's still alive. But he will die, just like Sean Bean. It's ironic, really. Sean Bean, it's like his whole career as an actor has been a preparation for the actual act of dying, which in a way is the ultimate act, because well, it's not actually acting, is it? Death is, isn't... shut up. Alan Bean was the fourth person to walk on the moon. Oh, I'm smart. Oh, I know more about the space program than I... It was Armstrong, Aldrin, Collins. No, not Collins. Pete Conrad. Pete Conrad. And then Alan Bean. Let's pop open Moonwalkers. That was dead air there. I should have said something. Yeah, Pete Conrad, Alan Bean. I'm right. I'm right. Not many of them left now. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 are dead. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 are still alive. Well, I suppose they were pretty healthy men when they were alive, so they're all going to live to a ripe old age. I'm going to have a swig of coffee now. So you're going to have a horrible sound effect. Right, that's enough about Alan Bean. Bean, the text editor. Where was he? I'm a Windows person, so this confuses me. In my opinion, the Windows taskbar and start menu is objectively superior, if only because it shows you what's running. I just don't like that. Which is irritating because in most respects OS X impresses me. For example, you get one version of OS X, there's no OS X Home Premium or OS X Professional, you get the whole bit, and it's got a terminal, it's basically like Linux, but it actually has applications. Who was? I'll just put who was full stop. And that's going to be my next blog post there. This is being a very simple text editor with a spell check at the moment. I've been able to who was and is. And that will be my next blog post. One thing that irritates me about OSX, or at least OSX 10.4, let's go to shut it down, shall we? So, we're shutting it down. Let's close the lid. Again, gingerly, we're gingerly closing the lid because I don't want to snap the hinges. It's amazing they've lasted this long. Now, the big problem at this point is that it hasn't actually shut down. It's gone into standby. Because it automatically goes into standby when you close the lid. You can't change that, or at least not in this version of OSX. I don't know if you can see that, but the little glowing light there. That's sort of hard-coded. So if we open it up again, what will happen is that it... With a whirring noise, it wakes from standby, and but because it's halfway through the shutdown sequence, it shuts down. That's sort of pointless. So let's pop it open again. I like that. I've done this once before, actually. I'll skip through this bit when I do the video editing later on. When I send it off to my South Korean editing bureau, they sort of edit it and master the sound and so forth. I'll instruct them to cut this bit out so that you don't have to watch it pop open the screen again. Let's open it slightly more. One thing you'll notice is that the screen wobbles backwards and forwards, which I assume doesn't do the hinges much good in the long term. Let's do a close-up shot of those hinges, shall we? Why not? Let's do a close-up shot of the hinges. There's one of the infamous hinges. You can see the paint's coming off. This part of the machine does tend to get very warm when the I assume the charging hardware, the actual charging port is here, and I assume that the power hardware is underneath it here. And for one thing, the power switch is really nice, it makes a clicking noise when it goes on. But what happens is the paint starts flaking off and it ends up looking like a fridge or something. It's not all that ugly because from the front you don't see it. But later Macintoshes, they generally had the hinge running along the middle here, which made a lot more sense, and also was more robust. The big problem with these things is that once the hinge breaks, the machine is totally dead and useless. There's no way that you can fix it economically, which is unfortunate because, I mean, you can change the memory easily enough, and the bottom of the machine comes off and you can upgrade the hard drive. And in theory, all the components are replaceable, but once the hinges are gone, you might as well just throw it away, especially bearing in mind that, I mean, unless you can get a second one for £5 or something, or you can find it in a dumpster, which is unlikely though, because again, the hinges break. Now, I've used it for about a year or so, and the hinges haven't snapped or creaked, but that's because I'm being really, really careful with them. I imagine that back in 2001, people must have just dumped them on the table, instantly whipped open the lid, and snap, the whole thing breaks. I mean, it doesn't even look particularly tough. It wasn't designed by Johnny Ive, by the way. It was designed by some other people who left Apple a few years later. Not sure if we're allowed to name them or talk about them on the internet. Let's point at something else. Let's move the camera off to the left a little bit. Now, another thing that, I don't know, it's like a miscellaneous detail, is that you can see there's a kind of a bulge here. I'm never sure if that's something that's just happened with age or if it's deliberately designed that way, so that if the titanium expands, it's got room to expand. The this bit here is titanium plate, and this thing around the outside is plastic. Apparently this tends to crack over time. I've always thought the plastic sort of lets the design down a bit, because it makes it look like a Sony Vaio or a PC laptop. So even though it's called titanium, only a minority of the components are actually made out of titanium. There's a card bus slot here that you can stick USB 2 things in. Let's take that out. I've got it sitting on top of a 2008 MacBook Pro. As you can see, they have the same 15-inch screen size, but as you can see, the MacBook Pro is slightly physically larger. The G4 is a bit thicker. But I think in general, the G4 probably has... So the volume is probably much the same, actually. The big thing, though, is that the modern MacBook, or the more modern MacBook, the more modern MacBook, feels a lot tougher, whereas the G4 feels a bit sort of flimsy. And why do I say flimsy? But it sort of flexes a bit and creaks when you pick it up. It's a very unscientific comparison there. It's also quite heavy, and I'd be very wary about subjecting it to abuse, whereas with the modern MacBook, there's absolutely no flex at all. The whole thing feels like a single piece of metal, which is basically what it is. Oh, it has a glossy screen as well, which also, because of these rounded edges, fits a lot better in a bag. It has a glossy screen, the modern MacBook, which is something I'm not fond of. You see the logo there, the original one, the G3 PowerBooks had the logo upside down. It's a boring, uninteresting trivia thing there. Now let's do some quality internet surfing with 10.4 Fox, which is a version of Firefox that works with PowerPC Macintoshes. Let's see how it copes with YouTube on this ancient machine. Let's look up Gangnam Style. Let's go back in time to the distant past. Now this came out in 2001. Gangnam Style is, I think, 2012 or something like that, but the past is pretty much the same, so I mean they almost coexisted. That's is this really the official video, or is this total spam? Let's see how badly it fails to play Gangnam Style. It doesn't even try. Well, that's good. 34 million. I thought it had many more. Is it doing something? No, I don't think it is. Oh, no, it is. It is trying. It's trying. Bloody hell. I can hear something anyway. And I can see still frames. Well, that was good while it lasted. If you can imagine that this is what the internet was like in 2001, except that
open Gangnam Style.
Actually, let's stop this. Let's stop this. Right, well, there you go. That was a little glimpse into the raw power of the G4. Surprisingly, the fan hasn't started wearing away. That's not really fair, because I was trying the Daily Mail's website. Everyone loves the Daily Mail. It's fantastic. And at this point, I've embarrassed myself in front of the world. As you can see, that the three things that interest me in the world are Detroit, Britney Spears, and Weymouth. Oh God, I should have cleared my browser history. That's literally all I do at home. I just have tea and read about Weymouth and Britney Spears. I think that people should leave Weymouth alone. It's been through an awful lot. It's going to slip into the sea eventually. And it's not fat, it's just big boned. Towns don't have, well, I suppose towns do have bones. Well, they have roads, don't they? The roads are like bones. No, actually, roads are a bit like arteries, if you think of it. Well, they do literally, well, they call them arteries, don't they? So what's a town's backbone? I suppose the, metaphorically, if a town had a skeleton, what would it be? It would be the rock on which it's, well, the rock, I think of rock as being skin. Hey, let's have a look at a lion mauling a Game of Thrones editor to death through her car window. Ah, in South African safari park. Now look at that. Oh God, it's eating her. Yeah, I suppose from the lion's point of view, the car is like a kind of a snail with like food inside. Is it going to? No, that's it. The reason I'm loading up the Daily Mail is firstly because it's popular, everyone loves it, and pretty much everyone agrees with its editorial stance, and also it punishes your browser because it's enormous. It takes ages to load. Dead people, hey? An incredibly loud bang. Well, I guess she was... that's what happens if you take a lot of cocaine, you see. Because he's a lawyer. Something about cruel trolls there. Gwyneth Paltrow swearing, which excites me. Manuka Honey. I guess she's given up on kale. And very ugly looking man there. He's a 57-year-old Lithuanian. Are there any attractive 57-year-old Lithuanians? I don't know. Not trying to insult the people of Lithuania then. Something about there's Nicki Minaj's extreme cleavage in striking sheer top for risque live show. Let's test the browsing capabilities of the G4 by loading up pictures of Nicki Minaj. Leaving little to the imagination. What I'm going to do is I'm going to scroll down to the comments where there will be people saying she's a hussy, she's a prostitute, she's not a woman, she's ugly, she's a hate, she's horrible, and so forth. There are hundreds of thousands of comments on the Daily Mail's website, which has Miley Cyrus right at the very top there. This is why faster computers were developed, incidentally, so that you could watch Nicki Minaj faster. There we go. I think the Daily Mail has overwhelmed IBM's PowerPC chip. Seriously, I was going to go to the comments because it's going to be something about how in the past everything was much better, how we should get rid of immigrants, how it's horrible that she forces us to look at her being... she's blacker than usual there. Usually she's not quite that black, but perhaps the camera has changed things there. Oh, come on, heaven's sake. Let's scroll down to the comments. If you're watching this on the internet, by the way, you can actually go to this actual website and obviously she shaves there because she doesn't seem to have any kind of bulge in the front bottom area. Yeah, you've made your point, Daily Mail. You've made your point. You've got a click out of me. Somewhere in the Daily Mail's headquarters they're wondering why on earth a single G4 running an ancient version of Safari is looking at comments about Nicki Minaj. Let's have a laugh at the comments. Let me see really good. Oh, surprisingly supportive comment there. As a young male, I cannot understand how you can call that sexy. From UKIP, we need you there. A young male who's obviously a UKIP supporter. I don't want to meet that man. He's got a moustache. He's a white man with a moustache and he's prematurely balding. Has she got any real body parts left? Well, she's sort of fake looking, but fake in an attractive way, like Katy Perry. Gross, 95%. Unlike in the past, for example, Madonna came out 30 years ago, she was like 100% music. Or, Yuck. It's fake. She looks like an angry Doberman. Silly fake wig. She spat in women's faces. You can sing fully clothed too. Well, yes, you can, but you can also sing. I mean, anyone who's sung in the bath or sung naked has demonstrated that you don't have to sing fully clothed, or you can sing partially clothed. And there's busty Amber Rose there. No, I've already done this once. Let's scroll down the... Seriously, when I was a kid, people used to mock Madonna and say that she was a fashion of pan, that she wasn't half as good as Cyndi Lauper. And I suppose, objectively, Cyndi Lauper had more chops. But... where is she now, eh? I've got nothing against Cyndi Lauper, but she's actually made a fortune from that musical she did. There's Mo Farah with his little tiny beard. And Nick Gibb there, the undiscovered Gibb brother. One of the younger, the next generation of Bee Gees, a bunch of ugly, stupid people. And Daily Mail, a bunch of ugly, stupid people. I mean, come on, they're just going through YouTube, putting up iconic... I mean, this is quite near the top. This is in the top 10% of the website. Extra time for histrionic. Or perhaps she was. I mean, who knows? her mother is my broken base for back, life-threatening injuries. Do we get to see? No, there's no blood. Well, there's a little bit of blood, but and strangely, Ed Miliband seems to be pushing the trolley there. I'll edit this down, obviously, when I finally upload it to my computer. I will edit this down. Can you do video editing with this? Did people do video editing with this back in 2001? I pity them. If they did, it would have been even it would have been very slow at the time. Was that something about Marilyn Monroe? I don't know. Oh, yes. Charles Kennedy. Poor chap. Let's Helena Bonham Carter. She cleans up well. Let's look at Helena Bonham Carter. Let's demonstrate the breadth of my interests here by looking at Helena Bonham Carter. This is what the internet was designed for. So that you could look at... So when the internet was designed, Helena Bonham Carter would have been like 12. Actually, no, she's surprisingly old, isn't she? She's in her 40s at least. Perhaps even 50s. 49. It's good that the Daily Mail always points out women's ages quite near the top. 49, so she's like really, really old, but makeup can do wonders. And I mean, people take the mickey out of Nicki Minaj for having enormous hips, but as you can see there quite clearly, Helena Bonham Carter has a vast bottom stroke hip area, and is in her own way just as fake and unreal as Nicki Minaj, but because, of course, she's white and she's got an apostrophe in her name. No, she doesn't have an apostrophe in her name, she's got a hyphen. She's got a hyphen. Her hyphen is still intact, even after being married to Tim Burton. I'd love to play with her hyphen. what do I say? Shut up. Dan Aykroyd's lost a bit of weight there. Let's see what the kind of, does it say, oh, you're a dog, you're stupid, you're ugly, you've got plastic surgery. No, it'll be like, she's got class or something like that. Because you know your masters. Yeah, this woman is beautiful. She could pass for even 30, could you imagine? High praise from some chap called JJJ from Yorkshire there. You know how to win the ladies, don't you? At this point, I find out that I haven't actually hit record or something, that all these precious witticisms have been lost. I like her. She's really gorgeous. She looks great. She's an original. And that's the Daily Mail. People read it mainly because they hate it. You know, it's like Emmanuel Goldstein from 1984. It's the 3 minutes hate. Except that with a PowerMac G4, it's not a 3 minutes hate. It's a 15-minute hate because that's how long it takes to load everything up. As Ice-T, who's turned into a white uncle. Your trendy but slightly suspicious white middle-aged uncle guy. What a chap. He's had an interesting life. Anyway, that's enough about that.